what do you want to get out of it?
I want to be as musically convincing as possible.
Well done. Well done. Well done. So, I'm convinced. I'm convinced. A couple of nitpicky things in the cadenza. And it's just, you know, I love your pacing and everything. Here's the thing to be careful about when you, as you do any kind of robotic, and that is to let the audience know where the strong beats are. So,
right.
If you're gonna be that delicate with that spot, after the first C, the next time you have to let anybody know when a downbeat is you play 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 notes before you get, so make sure that you just gently let them know, okay, downbeat is here, so they can begin to get into, okay, here we go, and then there's, so they know where you are. Just, don't hit them with a baseball bat, and you're a fine enough musician that you know how much to do with that. Just that, I mean, and then, so that you get this into a tune that's recognizable from the beginning of what you did before.
Yeah.
You know, does that make sense?
Yeah.
Just a personal quibble here is, I see where you're breathing and this, and I'm going to say, try and breathe here and here.
Okay.
Because then it makes this symmetrical.
Yeah, sure.
You know?
Yeah.
And if you're taking two breaths rather than one longer, then each of the two breaths can be shorter.
Yeah.
And you can simulate and possibly create the illusion of, I'm sure what you want to create illusion of, da, da, da. Mm-hmm. I'm sure you want to create that illusion.
Sure.
But the lungs don't allow that.
Yeah.
And the person couldn't walk in this room who could do that. Because they. So anyway, da, da. If it doesn't suit you, throw it out. But I think you can create a more symmetry.
Mm-hmm.
Can I go back to the beginning? This thing through here, this modal thing, where you have the half step here, and you have between F and G flat, and you have the half step between the C and the D flat.
Mm-hmm.
The modality of that. Make sure that those pitches are in your ear.
Mm-hmm.
Because sometimes I think we hear a whole step, instead of a half step.
Yeah.
And then our embouchure puts something in between, and the note doesn't come out clearly or as loudly.
Yeah.
And that happened with you.
Yeah. Okay.
So do me a favor, play that ba da 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 da. Just play that and play it slowly enough so that you get that in your ear.
Sure.
Start on the F. Yeah. Yeah. Do you hear embouchure wanting to lean toward G?
Yeah.
Yeah. Make sure it's a half step. Yeah, and again, a half step, from the C to the D flat. Okay, again. Stylistic content just yet. I'm looking for your ear to have these pitches so that this thing rings those pitches exactly.
Sure.
Oh, a little higher. You're just a little higher. Yep. There. Good. Keep going. Oh, see, there you go.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And listen. I know this because I went through the same thing.
Yeah.
I was sitting there, it's like, why is that lick not coming clean? Yeah. And I finally realized it's because my ear is hearing G natural.
Right. Yeah.
D natural instead of G flat,
Yeah.
And so as you play those, even here, same thing. Some notes didn't come out as clearly as others.
Yeah.
And the reason is because you're you're buzzing them higher than the note wants to resonate them.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
You know, so earlier today, I did this thing where I have this jagged line like this. You know, I'll turn this so folks can see. But you know, on a brass instrument, you know, we have like, all right, we're open notes. We're going to get F. We're going to get C. We're going to get F. You know, we're going to get A. Right. So, and then alongside this, we have this pitch range that we can buzz. We can buzz any of these notes. So if we happen to buzz like here, make it so everybody can see it. It's an approximation of C, but the horn doesn't let you in there all the way to resonate that note fully.
Right.
You know.
Yeah.
So I think when you play G flat, when your finger in G flat, let's transpose this up a tritone.
Yeah.
You know, when your finger in G flat and you're buzzing somewhere here,
yeah, right,
the horn doesn't let you in.
Yeah.
So as you're flipping through these notes, flying through these notes on these runs,
yeah,
you know, you know, some of the notes just and we're after that.
Yeah.
So does that make sense
to
you?
Yeah.
You know, so find this sweet spot.
Sure.
And you know, make sure that you're buzzing into that. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's a little bit stronger.
Okay, all right. So do that look again.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now blow through it all. Now do that a few more times, because here's the thing about practicing. What I found is, and when I practice, is that the first thing I get is an increased level of consistency.
Mm-hmm.
So rather than 2 out of 5, I start to get 3 out of 5, 4 out of 5, 5 out of 5.
Mm-hmm.
What I found is that if I don't speed up the metronome until I'm 5 out of 5, but beyond that, I'm 5 out of 5 and it's easy for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's when I speed up the metronome.
Right.
Because that's when I know my body and my mind and brain has encoded this whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm going to fly through there, and it's going to be. So I found that practicing slower for longer is actually speeds up the process,
mm-hmm,
that, you know, of where you want to end up.
Sure.
So can I just put you in a minute or 2 minute jail, and
yeah,
just, you know, just kind of have you go through that a bit? Now, the minute you go too fast where your mind is not around this,
mm-hmm,
slow it down.
Okay.
Now make sure air is going through there. I know you're getting like really picky with his. It doesn't work unless you've got air going through. So the air has to be the adult in the room. Jump the shark and ask you to take this up to tempo.
Okay.
In fact, can we go at 1? So I put you in a 1 minute jail. Look, you know, look at the parole that got you. You know, so, okay. That, that make sense? You know, as
yes.
a way to practice.
Definitely.
And do you realize how easy it sounds when I hear all of the notes
yeah.
dynamically even?
Yeah.
It sounds like this is no problem. So you know what's hard about this?
Yeah.
You know why would I do this?
Yeah.
Now one thing I want to do is like I'm watching you play. And I'm just dying to come up here, and you know, I hope I can put my hands on your shoulders without you being. But you know, I just want to have you, you know, because I see these all crunched
yeah.
up here. You know, I'd love for this to just, you know, just. Right, sure. So we live in a gravity environment. So anytime we want to bring power, it comes from here, right? So we're gonna bring, you know, if you see a baseball player swing a bat, where does it come? It comes from up here. Tennis player, boom, golf caller, you know, whatever it is.
Yeah.
You know, a boxer, the power comes from here. So if we're perched on this and we're not grounded and our shoulders are up here, we're floating and we're not making use of, you know, a three, one, two, three, you know, so where I can draw power. And you know, if I'm up here, it's energy wasted.
Mm-hmm.
You know, now
yeah.
you're strong enough so that it doesn't matter in this piece.
Yeah.
But you know, if you want more power for other things and ease of power. You know, it just needs to come from the floor. So
yeah.
feel it come up from the floor. Can I have you start this again?
Sure.
Of it, not where I'm blindfolded and I'm throwing a dart in the general direction of a dartboard,
mm-hmm.
but I'm focusing on the bullseye, you know, and I'm using this ear and this ear, which is when you went to play this lick that we worked on. I said ears,
yeah.
you know,
yeah.
use your ears. So, you know, once you know what that's about, and you're just moving air across all of this,
mm-hmm.
you know, you're so comfortable with this that you're feeling free to move air across this. You get this sweep of phrase, and you get an ease of playing and clarity that's really quite wonderful,
yeah.
you know? So, let me pick on you just a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
And what I noticed was how you played one, this right here,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to what you did, I believe, here.
Mm-hmm.
I like this one more.
Okay.
And why do you think I would say that? Same music, different key. It's down on minor third, but it's the same music. Why did I like this one more? You have any idea? It's how active the end of the note was.
Right.
Do you hear the lift at the end of the air?
Yeah.
And this one went.
Right.
Can it lift
yeah.
more?
Yeah.
Can we go at one? Yes. Do it so. those notes don't go like this and slide along the ground. Mm-hmm. These notes go. And when it's piano, oh, it's incredible. That's really great. Mm-hmm. One more. Swing and that groove is.
Yeah.
Why? Because I'm weighting the downbeats rather than weighting the note with regard to whether it's a higher or lower.
Yeah.
Note, you know?
Right.
So, you know, it's like syncopated things.
Sure.
And, you know, in the second movement, if you do that, you're going to be really in trouble.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yes.
This, you know?
Yeah.
So, and you know, see that keeps the audience in this swing that you've gotten them into.
Yeah.
Yeah, and you're not hitting them in odd places.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So can we go two? Sound great. And here's the point I want to make. Find what you do well. When you listen to somebody else play, find what they do well. And ask yourself, why does that sound so cool? And how can I get me some of that? You know, it just makes so much more sense to take what you like, take what's good,
yeah,
than to say, oh, man, you know, that person just like totally messed that up. Well, good for you for noticing. You know, everybody in the world knows that.
Yeah.
So And how does that raise your own game?
Yeah.
Not at all. You know? So look for what's good in your own playing as well. So what note do you think you play the best in this? Any note. Just choose, and there are a couple of them. So just choose a note that you played really well consistently every time. And would you show me what that is?
I like my E's.
Which ones?
The bottom of the higher ones.
Okay. So play one of those. What do you like about it?
I like the fullness and consistency of sound.
Okay, good. Do you like the way that one started?
I wasn't thinking about it.
Had a little burp.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So can I get a clean one?
Mm-hmm.
Now, back to this. Alright, so now we're going to go A, E, A, C sharp, okay? You're coming into this one here.
Okay.
And then the horn is banging it down into here.
Right.
And, you know, once you get the note going, you are in here, which is why you like it, and you are correct to like it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? But I think you're starting it high. So can I ask you to miss it low and see what that sounds like? Miss it lower. That's where it lifts. That's where the note lifts. And what's great about that is you do know where it lives, but you go and knock on the door where that lives, and the doorknob is over here, and you know. The door's over here, and you're just slightly off. So you know it's like here.
Yeah.
So would you do that a couple more times? Just again, what we want to do is we want to encode that. We want to encode that in how we hear it. We want to encode our body into how to produce that. It's almost like the horn starts the note for you and it's reflection back.
Right.
You know, you're not starting it here, you're loading it in from here, but you're loading it into a place that's out here. The horn reflects it back to you, and if you've hit the bullseye, the horn loads it back to you. And what we get is a note that sounds like you've recorded it and you've taken off all the schmutz at the front of the note and you've spliced that out of there. And you're just left with a note that comes out of the instrument immediately, fully in bloom.
Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
More E's, please. Exactly. So you're letting the accuracy of the frequency of the buzz combined with an immediate air load into the instrument, you're having those two things do most of the work of starting the note.
Mm-hmm.
And when that happens, all the trash, this is going to be a gross sound, but you know that we added, you know, all that trash is scrubbed out of the sound.
Yes.
So I just get to ha immediately. So any note that doesn't sound immediately in full bloom, this is why.
Yeah.
This is why. There's armature inaccuracy and or too much tongue compression.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay, now, a note you seem to miss like all the time is the low G sharp. So can I have you play a low G sharp and, you know, take this thinking to and apply it to that and see what you get. And hold the note for a while.
Okay.
so that you can remember where the note lives. This you know, the note lives here. And this is how much airflow I need for this dynamic.
Right.
This is where my embouchure goes, so I'm in this pocket.
Mm-hmm.
And when I'm in this pocket, I've reached an efficiency point of this horn.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know, this thing is going to leverage my work to the greatest degree and give me the most sound for the least amount of work that I'm getting. So It's so much better. What you just did is not where we, it's not the end game yet, but it's 90% towards it compared to all the G sharps you played when you played this in context.
Yeah.
That makes sense?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Can I have some more G sharps? And again, it's not that. Start what you follow through with. It's a wonderful load in of air. You hear how fast the note started?
Yeah.
No squirreliness at the front of it. But then you went.
Right. Okay.
You know. Follow through. The note lives down there. Oh wait. Did you notice the release? You detuned the embouchure before you took the bow off the string.
Yeah.
You know. You took your finger off the string before the bow was done.
Yeah.
So. You ever seen a string player? Bow comes off the string, and they're sitting there like this. They're not detuning that string.
Yeah.
Well, the way we do that, we stop the air, but the embouchure stays in tune. And what it'll get you is ring off in the room, follow through. The note will have follow through, which is great for covering breasts, and we always need to cover our breasts.
Yeah.
So it's something you really need to build into your playing
as
a default. All the time.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
So don't detune until well after the air stops. See, you're changing your armature?
Mm-hmm.
You're the end of the note?
Mm-hmm.
So have the release be an active stop of the air. Let's do this. Release what I give you a key. See, that way you had enough air to shove that note off into the room. Again? Yeah. Again? Ta, 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 ta. Ta, ta. Oh, sorry, I sang badly. I sang it wrong.
B.
Yeah. Yeah, I want E, B. E, no, E, B, G sharp, low E. Ta, 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 ta. That's incredible. Okay, wait. Ta, ta, active release. Yes! Okay, now, we got to do the same thing on the low E as we did on the G sharp. But do you see where this is going?
Yeah.
I absolutely loved the B. Mm-hmm. There was so much ring off in that room. And it was a lovely pickup into the E.
Yeah.
You know, the E sounded like a downbeat, even at the tempo that you played it.
Yeah.
Because you left lift and you left dynamic so that you could wait the E and tell everybody, this the B is the pickup, the E is the downbeat.
Right.
You know, and you told everybody. So immediately, you've got them into this musical rocking chair. Like, you know, we got swing going on. And you know, the faster you can create swing in your listeners, the faster they on board with, like, what you're up to. Mm-hmm. Now, for the low E, tubas have the spring.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, especially Albright's instruments, but tubas especially. When we get down to that register, it's a spring. And the spring has less resistance down there, and it has further to travel. Mm-hmm. You know, so it can turn into this. So it's really critical that once we determine how much flow of air we're going to lay into an instrument or a given note,
mm-hmm.
that we follow through with what we start.
Yeah.
Otherwise, the air is changing, and then you're making your embouchure change that, and you know that's not fair to embouchure.
Yeah.
So, low E with an active release like that—that's fabulous. That's just fabulous. Now, can we learn from the end of that note how awesome that was? That's the setting for the beginning of another E. Okay, so let's go to school on the end of that E then play another one and see if we can't just drop it in right where we left it off. So it lives a lot lower than you think it did.
Yeah.
Do you hear when you get the frequency of the buzz down into here, what happens to the sound? Wow.
Yeah.
You know, it opens up. And again, we have efficiency. There's just a ton of sound. And you're not going, you're going, yes, I'm moving air through, but I'm moving air that way.
Mm.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Now, what you're finding is a floor of the fly.
Mm.
Now, when the instrument is full, I do this gag with people. When the instrument is full, it gives you this. When the instrument is not full, it gives you this. So E can be here, 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 here. So in order to get E to be here, the instrument has to be full.
Mm-hmm.
And it has to remain full and be steady. You know? So, and what you're finding is this spot. Now, there's a certain sound when you're above the slot, and that is, it doesn't have resonance. It doesn't have space, and it doesn't have resonance in the sound.
Mm-hmm.
The sound you get when you're below the slot is a soggy. And you'll feel the instrument want to pull you back up.
Mm-hmm.
So let's go slowly enough so that you can start to find where this place is, mindful that down low, if the air is not steady, it starts this long traveling, gentle spring. And it surely delays you finding this spot.
Mm-hmm.
So commit to a certain dynamic.
Sure.
There it is, it's down there. You're finding it. Right there. That's where he lives. Is they empty out our lungs so fast that we don't get very long to hear them, and we don't get very long to create muscle memory and encode it.
Yeah.
You know? So low register tough stuff takes about four times as long as it does on. So just know that going in. But you're on the path you need to be on to be able to find these notes. And then, you know, so getting to play this really well. It's just a whole lot of this until you know where every one of these notes lives. And here's the thing. The E is probably going to take you the longest. F sharp, about half as long. G sharp, look how far you've come with G sharp. So it's coming. So it seems like progress is glacial at first.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually it will speed up. It'll get going. And the thing to know is, load your ear to the resistance point, and then leave it there.
Yeah.
And the resistance point is gonna feel at least this far down the line, if not around the bend.
Yeah.
You know. So does that make sense to you? So
yeah.
do you feel like you have a plan to,
absolutely,
you know, to get that going? So have I left you with any questions?
No.
Am I?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So have I?
Thank you.
why are you playing this for me and these people, and what do you want to get out of it?
Like ultra smooth lines. And
That's a good thing to go after.
Yeah, and then just the placement of like the.
So, did you go to school?
Yeah.
So I'm not going to reiterate that because you're not an idiot, you know. I'm quite sure of that, you know. And you can take now. Since you brought up legato, what makes a good legato?
Just airflow, just no stopping in the air.
That's correct.
Yeah,
but it's only half correct.
Okay.
If I go da ha ha. I was a pretty good boy. I kept my air going. What did you say?
Yeah.
Did I have a legato?
No. So it's just consistency of air.
My air was consistent. Ha 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 ha. What dropped out?
The ends of the note.
Buzz stopped.
Oh. Yeah.
So I tell people buzz through slurs. Because you can't buzz through slurs if you don't blow through slurs. But you can blow through slurs and not buzz through slurs. And if you do that, you don't have legato because the notes aren't connected.
Right.
Oh. Buzz never stopped.
Yeah.
And so I want to describe a slur as a glitz. Because vocally it is. If I slow it down, da, right? You know, da. So it's just a question of how fast do I do the glitz? Da, da, da. So buzz, buzz, buzz. Better?
Yeah.
I do too. You know, and are you worried about your face? It sounds like you're not.
No.
You know, it doesn't sound like you're worried about your embouchure. You're just relaxing it and letting it buzz, and you're letting the air carry through. And here's the thing. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Just five notes. Mm-hmm. I say this all the time. Air is stupid. It's essential, but stupid. Okay? It knows five things. Start, stop, increase, decrease, stay the same. Everything your air is going to do is going to be one of those five functions. So in this case, we want the air to start and stop, but through five notes, it doesn't change. Da. It doesn't know the difference between that. Da. The embouchure does, but the air doesn't. So can I have just the air just go, oh. We getting easier?
Yeah.
Now, do me a favor. It seems to be G flat, A flat, or G sharp, A flat time.
Yeah.
what you learn about is A flat. G sharp.
In this case,
we're going to spell it A flat.
Sure. It was high. It was too high. So
can I hear you play A flat? And all I want you to do is I just want you to lower the frequency of the buzz and just settle down into the note. Now, do you feel the efficiency come into play?
Mm-hmm.
So there's a reason I brought this chair out before, is because both of you guys are playing this note. Here's the note, and you're playing it like this, right? You know, my butt is close to where it wants to be, but I sure am doing a lot of work, and right about now my quads are yelling at me, you know? So if I go like this, my quads stop yelling at me, my body does less work, I'm free to find this efficiency point.
Yeah.
So can we find that on that note? Buzz lower. because it won't drain your lungs so quickly.
Yeah.
Okay? And we can find this faster. Would you do me a favor, just hold in the dah and do an active release? As brass players, I see this a lot, where we load into an instrument, and we tongue it, and we hope we're not late, we hope we're not out of tune, and we hope we don't miss the note. And if we do that, we're done. Except we're not. You know, and if we're good at that, good for you. I don't mean to demean your work, you know, but wait, there's a middle and an end of a note that is being ignored. And I think, you know, I get a feeling like once you start a note, you think you're done. And you're not. Da, da. You know, so I've got a shape of the middle of the note in my mind, which my air needs to support, you know, me in achieving. And then I've got a definitive point in time where the note is going to end and how it's going to end. Da, da. There's all kinds of things I can do to the end of the note, but I know exactly when it's going to end.
Yeah.
Da. So what I would like you to do is conceive of the end of the note so that it changes the middle of what you do, and it changes the direction, and it creates forward motion of the note and makes the listener anticipate that there's a next note to come.
Right.
Da. Your best sound on that G? For me, it was right at the end of the note.
Yeah.
It was the most open, easy, and resonant. Mm-hmm. So, and it also happened to be where you relaxed into it.
Yeah.
And found efficiency.
Yeah.
And see, the thing is, if you play short notes like that,
right,
your body never gets to experience, and your ear never gets to experience what's possible. So hold it until you find it. Come on. No. Down, down. There we are. Release. Now, look, you just did at least 50% of that note doing the behavior that you want to teach your body.
Yeah.
That's the behavior that you want to encode and make default in your body. That's the sound that you want your ear to begin to hear. So that this is what I'm going after. And this is what I expect to hear and want to hear right from the beginning.
Right.
Now, if you make a mistake and then stop, look what you're teaching yourself.
Yeah.
That's just one more piggy bank in the side of the equation that you don't want to.
Right. Yeah.
That you don't want to multiply.
Mm-hmm.
Make sense?
Yeah.
So hold the note long enough so that you can find where you want to be. Oh, listen to the oh, release. Oh. A flat just needs to be a little lower. All the notes were so much better sound than you've made so far. All of them, except for the, and even the A flat. And we can get the A flat better. But, so just buzz the A flat lower.
Yeah.
Do that again.
Because that sounds fabulous.
That's it. Okay, now, go ahead and take a breath here. I back to the drawing board. This is for tuba players especially, but it really has a bearing on everybody else. So I'm just gonna draw a shape of an imaginary phrase, one I just made up. But say it goes like this. Say I want, you know, a phrase, and you know it can be long, it can be short, doesn't matter. So as a wind player, then I'm gonna take and I'm gonna put a bass line, a flat line, underneath of this, and that's the air input I need to be able to put into my instrument over time.
Yeah.
Okay. Now that can be two notes. It can be 16 bars, whatever it is. Now, here's the point I want to make. We still have the friction. Haven't ruined it, have I?
No.
So what does that mean? It means my breath doesn't have to ruin a fresh air. What it does mean is that I've got to be cognizant of where this part of the phrase fits into the overall whole. And I can't have, say, this note tire out before I go into the next phrase.
Yeah.
And certainly after my breath, because I've got a lot of air, I can't have this note start like that. Because that way, I've shown everybody there's a breath here. So what it requires is discipline at the end of your note and discipline, dynamic discipline, at the beginning of the note after the breath, which is going to allow you what? It's going to be able to allow you to create, you know, whatever you have in mind for this. Okay?
Yeah.
So it means that you can breathe after the first A flat, but you can't have the end of your A flat go. Which is why we were talking about active releases that lift and follow through in the room, so that you can begin to have the skills to create this. Okay? Again? Somebody like wrestling with a tuba, you know. And we all know what that is, you know. Been there, you know. And even on my best day, you know, I still wrestle with the tuba, but I wrestled with it trying to create Penn and Teller, create a musical illusion, you know. Don't look here while I take a breath. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Now, do you realize how much more centered your sound is? Full? Easy?
It's nice.
Are you doing this?
No.
No. You're just gently filling the tuba.
Yeah.
And look what it's giving you.
Yeah.
So. Now, let's jump ahead a little bit. Let's go here.
Okay.
Yeah, let's go here. Why am I doing this? Why do you think? Exactly.
Yeah.
And what do you now know that you're going to attempt
to play it low?
Yeah, and full. and follow through with the air load in once you initiate it.
Okay.
Follow through with what you start.
Yeah.
Okay, let's see how it works. Start with confidence. You know, if with your air,
mm-hmm.
if the embouchure is in the wrong place, take it. Because then the air can say to the embouchure, dude, I'm moving. You get in tune before I move. I'm going to go back to this. You know, this is efficiency. And you want every little bit of efficiency on this thing you can get. Because they're just, you know, they're just vacuum cleaners for your lungs. You know?
Yeah.
Just gone. You know? Okay? Do it again. Now, can I have it be in three? Dee da da blood on it all free.
Okay.
Do me a favor. I hear this hitch on the front of the B flat, right? So can I hear you just play a B flat and go da da da? Now your first one should be like the second, third, and fourth one. So you know, create it in your mind that it's already moving. That is to say, when you take a breath. Take a breath with the idea of B flat embouchure on the way in, so that yes, I love it. That's fabulous. Good for you. So that's hold your feet to that fire, okay? Because that's beautiful. Okay. Here, you know, you look at this thing and you think, okay, there's nothing fast in here. Wrong. There is something fast. A leap like that means a fast move. Now, we don't want to give away how fast we're moving, so we don't want to do anything with our air to give it away because we want it to sound like it's easy. But it's a fast move, and it's a far move. I love the way you start this. Good for you. Let's try with this idea in mind that we can do this and we can take more breaths. And if we take more breaths, breaths can be faster because there's not so much of a tank to fill up. So can I have you? We're just going through this and we're finding what this particular instrument wants, you know, and then putting it there. Now, the advantage you have on this note is that the dynamic is softer, so we can play it a little longer before our lungs are out of air and sort of gain remembrance of where the note lives.
Right.
Exactly. And, you know, and start to be able to do this. And back to the end, the idea of ending notes actively with a tail that's sort of not pitch wise but just shape wise with a tail that goes up. That make sense?
Yeah.
Try that. not limp into the end of this phrase as much. So if that's the case, I'm gonna look for a solution that so I don't I don't have to come into the end of the phrase like that. Musically. Does that make sense to you?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So the other thing I just want to throw out there is this. This is a sarabande. And my understanding of a sarabande has always been 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
Yet I don't hear anybody ever play this that way, and I'm not sure why. You know, so I'm not sure if you played that in an audition. I'm not sure I'd do that in an audition, but I sure would think about it, given that it is a sarabande, and that, you know, so food for thought, you know, for better minds than me to think about. But yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Do you want to play something in your F?
Sure.
You call it.
Okay, that's in the.
Okay. Play G on this tuba and let it settle down. Come down. No. How about that?
Yeah.
Is that where you're playing all these notes?
No.
You're not playing any of them.
Yeah.
You know, and so I, you know, I want to implore you to play all of them there. What may happen is once you start doing that, you may find the tuning slide built in, because you know the horn is this long. You're playing up here. And assuming that this is in tune, once you start playing down here, you may find yourself low. So what we want to do is push the tuning slide in and follow the horn up so we're back in tune.
Yeah.
We're not there yet, but in the future, I just want to warn you that may occur.
Right.
Okay. Now, the other thing that happens when you're up here is that the aperture gets flat and not circular. So it gets... Instead of,
yeah,
you see how much more air is coming through there?
Yeah.
So, yeah. Let it come down, and blow gently to this place. You know what? Before we do this, I want to do one thing for you. blow a stream of air past my ear. Can you feel that slight resistance change?
Yeah.
Right? I'm not touching you, but you can still feel it, okay? Again, another stream of air. No buzz. No buzz. Do you feel this resistance point? Good. Now, when you play G, I want you to feel this resistance point and not a resistance point that you create here.
Okay.
Blow to the resistance that's out here. Buzz to the resistance that's out here. There you go. Now, da, da, active release, da. So to here. Blow easy. Yeah. Now there's a sound. Do you hear how clear, open, resonant, easy it is? Somebody's liking it because, you know, I'm hearing this. And, you know, listen, I mean, what's great about a laboratory like this is when you start talking to people that are out here and they're liking what you're doing, and somebody's reacting to that, take that to the bank. That's a really good thing. All right, now, one other thing before we finish out, and I want to talk about this. Talk to me about elements of musical style, musical character.
Like for this piece, or
any just music. Period. Any elements of musical character, no matter what you can think of.
The front of the note.
Yep.
Dynamic.
Yep. Keep going.
Length.
You're doing great.
Length.
Yep.
Contrast.
Contrast to what? Okay, I'm gonna fold that into here.
Sure.
Okay.
Ends of the note.
Good.
Of the sound.
Ends. Good. And if we have front and we have ends, what do we also have?
Middle.
Good. Now, let's talk about two notes. How we get from one note to another. What's involved? Is there space? Is there space or not space? If there is space, how much? Does one note bump into the next one, or does one note go and there's a little lift and then there's another lift, and you know, is it like that, or is it connected but there are lifts, so we get, you know, a wave pattern. So the point I'm trying to make here is that so much music happens after the initiation of the note. There's so many opportunities to create a musical character and a musical style. And you have to mind the middle and the ends of the notes. That is to say, the shapes of them, you know, the length of them, the ends of them, how they end. Now, if we have a timeline here and we have, assume these are perfectly measured and they're all even. So if I have a length of note that lasts this long, and a note of length that lasts this long, and a note so on and so forth, and assuming these are all the same, and assuming these are all the same, the corollary is that the gaps between them are also all the same. So when that happens, what we see is this consistency of rhythm. And so you feel incredibly locked down rhythmically. And I hear you not minding what happens after the thumb notes. You know, because sometimes you bump into the next note, sometimes you lift out of it, sometimes you even slur into it where it's not slurred, it's articulated. You know, so I want you to pay attention to this. And so here's what I'm going to advocate. You make some practice loops for yourself where you take a character of eighth note, top, 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 and you put on a metronome, one, two, three, four, top, 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 top. And you make enough of them to get you through the trill and into the G. Okay? And then you make another loop where top, 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 where the eighth note is slightly longer. And you make another loop where the eighth note is shorter. Top, 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 top. And you want to be able to play the ink such that if you have a dotted quarter, your dotted quarter ends in exactly the place your 38th note does. Because what that's going to mean is that the space between your dotted quarter and the next note is going to be the exactly the same space that happens between the eighth notes. And so people are going to listen to that and think, oh, that's just incredibly rhythmically solid.
Yeah.
You know, and the reason I came across this, because, you know, I was playing this for my teacher, and, you know, I learned this, and man, I could play this with a metronome. There was just like, you know, the metronome and I were walking down the street holding hands. You know, we were just the best of pals. And you know, I played this for my teacher, and I said, yeah, that's not rhythm. And I thought, wait a minute, you know, I can play this with a metronome. And I know that I'm fairly close if the metronome goes away. But he heard it as not in rhythm. And I finally figured out that what he was hearing was difference in gaps between the notes. You know, and then once I figured that out and played it for him, he said, yeah, that's how it goes. You know?
Yeah.
So, it was just me going through the weeds to figure out what that was.
Yeah.
So, and then I'll tell you where I get my eighth note character for this. The second violins. They're off the string. So there's the eighth note character that I'm going. So, and making that practice loop helped me end those notes and keep this in a consistent character. And the other thing is, you want these notes to F of S off of the floor. You never, you know, how many brass instruments are you playing with here? Like none?
Yeah.
Exactly. So you're playing with wooden instruments. You're playing with basses, bassoons. You're playing with wooden instruments. So it, you know, it requires a different color and a different way to begin notes. So I'm going to get the majority of the work of sounding that note to come from that. Unless I'm just going to put enough on there just to have a little ping, you know? But I want to get a pitch and tone as quickly as I can. And understand, pitch and tone comes from air movement. There's no pitch and tone.
Yeah.
Never. You know, I can do the worst thing a brass player will ever do and close my glottis. And I can still do that. You know, so understand there's no pitch, timbre, and tone in that. So get the air moving as fast as you can. So can you try the beginning? I know I've just dumped a whole bunch of stuff on your plate, but, and you know, I don't expect you to unwind it now, but see what you can do. Okay, here. Let me just do this with you. You know, when I inhale and exhale, if I have time, I can stop and suspend for on both ends of it. But sometimes I don't want that. I want, so I've just conceived of this little, put a little loop on the end of one of the directions. So I can turn around my breath smoothly, so I don't get any hitches in. Yes. Subdivision in your mind does?
Yeah.
Do you see how locked down that sounds?
Yeah.
And you know, and you're not slugging on anything. You're having air movement do the work of getting everything going. And it's an active release, you know, one that, you know, the note lifts up at the end of the day, and it's just changes everything. Okay?
Yeah,
any
so
questions?
No.
Any confusions? I haven't confused you?
No, you're good.
Okay, all right, great. Thank you. Negate that.
Breathe.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. And so, okay, let's do something crazy. Put your trombone down for a second. And lean back in your chair and be comfortable. You know, everybody in the room can do this. Actually, hold up your left leg. Just one left leg. And we're going to hold it up long enough so that we get a sense of where the tension is.
Yeah.
You know, in my quad, maybe in your core, because you know, because you're having to hold this up. And then what we're going to do is we're going to exhale and we're going to let it go. Now, if you're like me, my left leg feels a lot more relaxed than my right one. You know? So I would do this as I was going to sleep, you know, in bed. I remember in the Houston Symphony, trying to, you know, find relaxation. And so I would do the same drill with my left leg and my arm. And then I would imagine that I'm holding up my left leg and get a sense of the tension. And then I would imagine that I'm releasing my left leg. And again, my left leg felt more relaxed than my right leg. And then for my torso, I would imagine that it's a beach ball, you know, and I pulled the plug, you know, and the air is going out. And what I was attempting to do was find a state of relaxation of my body with my mind alert.
Yeah.
You know, get my body as relaxed as I could. Well, the funny thing was, dumb luck me, you know, I pulled out this thing, and the way I conceived of it was to exhale. So I set up this biofeedback loop where, to me, to exhale was to relax, you know? And so I got lucky because, like, I play the tuba. I'm right, you know. So as the nerves ratchet things up, I had this counter mechanism of moving air through it to try and relax. And you know, once I did this enough, it became a feeling, a place, a mental place I could go to with one stupid little cue, you know, to relax me, to, you know, to go through there. So I just offer that as a way to get it. Now, some notes sounded great and others didn't. And what do you think the difference is? Yeah, it is. And you know, the other thing I think where I'd like to go with you is, and it works out great because it's different than what everybody else experienced. And I'd love to talk about different ways of initiating notes. So the way I see it is we have two levers that we can pull to regulate how a note starts. One is how much tongue compression we have, you know, and the other one is the shape of air that we load into the instrument over duration. So understand, for that, for us to talk about that, we have to also talk about duration too, you know. So this race is getting a lot of use today. So I can have a note start like this, which I find hard to do.
Yeah.
Clean front, you know, no change at the front of it. I find that difficult to do. You know, then we can have a note that goes like this, where it's quite stinging. Ta! You know, there's the change is fast and dramatic, and you know, a big change, and it happens fast, transient, you know, really quickly. Then, you know, we could also have something that goes like this. Well, that's a terrible drawing, but you get what I'm after.
Yeah.
You know, and I can stick compression on the front of that if I want, or I can take it off. And so I have these two levers to pull on, and I can create a whole palette of different ways to start notes, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And again, this is all separate from dynamic, and it's all separate from pitch. I want to be able to do any of these things in any dynamic and on any pitch I want to play. So you know, just to think about stuff like this. So my question is, this has just tons of articulation, you know? You chose it. So but so anyway, so it affords an opportunity to show somebody, this is the character of articulation that I've chosen here, and I think it's appropriate for this music. And not only that, I can do it in Delicasco, you know, and nothing's ever going to go off the rails with that. Now, sometimes when notes don't speak, it's because of this thing, you know. Sometimes there's embouchure error, you know, and if you're high or low, the horn doesn't let you into it, you know, to produce. So that's where I want to go with you with these articulations. So an exercise and a game that I used to do with myself was, does everybody do crescendo decrescendos on one note? You know, we should, because you know there's a whole lot to be learned from that. So I would do an articulation crescendo decrescendo of sorts, where I would choose one note, one dynamic, and I would go ta 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 where I would, you know, I would up the compression on a series and then bring it down so that I got a handle on you know, the compression lever absent the dynamic lever and absent the shape duration. So, in order for a note to speak quickly, it has to be tuned first before you load air into it. It's, you know, it's why when I go over here, that note sounds that way. String's pre-tuned, you know. So we need to have our string pre-tuned before, and then when it's pre-tuned, then it allows us latitude to begin to do some of the stuff that I was drawing, you know. So So let's find, let's just go an F. This piece is an F, so fine. Yeah. You know, an F's a great note. So let's just play a series of F's where da da da. Start the tongue with more compression. Do you hear the note get louder? Now, when you tongue less, do you hear the dynamic come down?
Yep.
So I would love for you to be able to. Separating out these two levers, do you see what it buys you in terms of of finesse and and how you can, this section's doing that. Okay, I hear that. I can match that.
Yeah.
You know? And you're gonna be able to hear it. Why? Because you practice this.
Yeah.
You know, so your ear is gonna get used to hearing it. And you know, your ear is gonna be more adept at hearing what other people, okay, this is what they're doing. I know how they're doing it, and I know how to do that, and so I'm gonna fold right into this. I know this isn't a section thing, So can I have more initiation of air? And the other thing I want to have you understand too is when we play a loud note, most of us are willing to load in air really quickly. You know, we're willing to go from zero to, say, 100 really quickly. The problem is when we play softer, if we're going 0 to 40, it usually comes, right? So we need to go. Being slapped in the face with tongue compression, you know? Yet it starts quickly, it sounds easy.
Yeah.
Now, some notes aren't sounding as loud as others, and the reason for that is embouchure error. You know, you've just, maybe the D comes and you know, everybody knows where first position is, but you know, there's this giant move from first to fourth, you know? Bom, bom. And you know, and a fourth is nebulous. You know, if this isn't in the right place, and or this isn't in the right place, and we don't hit here, then that note doesn't speak as loudly, it doesn't resonate the same way, and you know, we've got an issue. Yeah. So, play me a D. That's not starting as fast as your B flat. And you know why? Yeah, because you're above it. And as soon as you get down here, then the horn spits it off. Even lower. No, here's the problem with trombone players. You tell them lower, and they've got this infinite thing here. They can do it. So you tell them lower, and they raise this down here. The problem is, I want the embouchure to go lower, and you've just done this, so you've taken it further away. So. It's that, and what's so doggone hard about this is it goes so quickly. So
yeah.
I mean, you have to be so fluent in knowing one where fourth position is, and the fourth position for this D,
because
that's going to be a different fourth position than G, right? So you know where this fourth position D is, and your right hand knows where it is, and your embouchure knows it goes right here. It's a lot, you know. It's a lot to teach a human being to do that. So if somebody's really good at that, you gotta say salute, and you're really good at a lot. You know, it's just we're just trying to get that last 5%. You know, so okay, wanna have another go?
Yes.
That first B flat arpeggio was fabulous. Just fantastic. it just popped right out of the horn. It sounded so easy, sounded so even. You know, understand this, when something sounds even, the audience perceives it as easy.
Yeah.
So when you practice,
yeah.
look for even dynamically, even articulation, even shape of note, even length of note, even release of note, even space between notes, you know, even everywhere
yeah.
you can go. So, and you know, like I said, it's a lot.
Yeah.
It's a lot. And there's a reason that this is a usual suspect.
Yeah.
You know? So, the first arpeggio was lovely. I'm going to say it again because it was awesome. Do you have a metronome that subdivides?
Yes.
Hopefully it's a doctor beat because those things just crank
out.
Oh, that's I love it because you know they put on these little foam things. You know, if you play with any dynamic, you know they're just like lost. But a doctor beat is like slamming it in your face. And we need it. Okay? You're doing great.
Okay.
Keep doing it. Yeah. I might start singing 16ths.
Okay.
Between the G and the F sharp, right?
Mm-hmm.
And when you stop air, I don't want you detuning your embouchure. It's in other words, it's your embouchure is not going to care whether A's or air is going through it or not.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a string da 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 da. If the bow's on the string, the finger's going to do the same thing. If the bow comes off the string, the finger's going to do the same thing.
Yeah.
So tuning's tuning. Up. Now the first B flat, sometimes top.
Yeah.
Make sure that your aperture stays open.
Yeah.
Because you know you want top, 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 top. Let's play a little bit.
Top.
Release it when I cue you.
Okay.
Close it off.
Yeah.
Go. Yeah. There you go. There you go. That's. Do you hear how it follows through in the room?
Yeah.
And you didn't detune the embouchure until the note was done ringing in the room.
Yeah.
So, you know, now you're the string player that takes the string off the bow and
yeah.
you know, and they're doing this, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, da, 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 da. You know, now imagine D and F and B flat
yeah.
following that. So that's the shape of the first few notes, right? So I don't want your ear to be concerned about what note your Amish is playing, and I don't want it to be concerned about what your right hand is doing.
Okay.
Okay? Yeah, now that has sweep. You know? That's going somewhere.
Yeah.
You are not letting the instrument play you at that
right.
point. You're playing the instrument.
Yeah.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Do it again. And again. Da, 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 de, da, da. Right? Easy. Start easy. Yeah. Now, on this next one, we want to start easier because we have a long way
right,
to go.
Right.
Okay? Sorry.
No, that's okay.
Such a different animal
right.
when you do this. you know, it's just a whole, it's a whole nother ball game. Okay,
yeah.
Any questions about that?
No.
So I wanted to leave like 5 minutes, 10 minutes for questions, but I yak too much.
Yeah. A quick question somebody's dying to ask before we
Thanks, man.
No,
nice
thank
job.
You.
I'm curious if you could talk a little bit about injury prevention, chop maintenance, and just how to keep an overall healthy armature.
You know, I'm the last guy that ought to be talking about this. I'm really, honestly, you know, I mean, you know, mine crapped out on me. You know, we don't know whether dystonia is overuse or whether it's genetic predisposition or, you know, what, you know, we don't know the causes of it. What I would say is that if you're tired, stop. And what I would say is never end tired. If you're tired, warm down. Play in his register gently for a while so that you don't start with balloons the next morning. You know? You know, one thing, you know, like weightlifters do is they stretch too. So, you know, and give it a rest. So maybe you take a hard day, maybe you take, you know, an easy day. You know, we want to build strength and endurance, but we want to do it responsibly, gently, slowly, so that it lasts longer than mine did, you know? So.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you again, Warren. Thanks, Patrick. Thanks, Max.
Nice
Thanks
job,
Gary.
Nice job, you guys. I'm so grateful for you guys being here. You having me here. You know, and I'm grateful you tolerate me being here. So I feel